Oh, hi. I didn't see you there.
The pandemic still rages on, and theaters everywhere are closed, forcing me to go outside and listen to the monotonous glory of birdsong.
But fortunately, there is a solution. You see, back in the day, people used to rush home from their jobs at the fish mines to listen to top-quality audio theater broadcast into their homes every night.
Today, we can listen to those same riveting dramas on the go, at last allowing me to drown out those annoyingly glorious birds.
But which ones should I listen to, you ask? Well, I'm about to tell you in my ruggedly good-looking baritone. We're going to split this into two lists, the first of which following the golden age of radio, and the second, the era immediately following it. And so, I present...
Williams' Top 5 Audio Drama Series, 1930 to 1969. Starring me! Number 5, Sherlock Holmes. Sherlock Holmes is the most loved detective in fiction. I don't even think that's debatable.
There are plenty of adaptations in the classic era of radio of the good detective and his companion Dr. Watson. Plenty of actors took on the role of Sherlock and Dr. Watson in the 30s and 40s, but by far the most iconic of that era was Basil Rathbone and Nigel Bruce.
The pair played the duo 14 times on film, and even more impressive, 220 times on radio. These are a blast to listen to for any consulting detective fan. They're a mix of Conan Doyle's adaptations and entirely new mysteries.
They have this really great framing device where each week the sponsor of the show tries to sell you something before going to Dr. Watson's house in Los Angeles to get the story for the week. For some reason, the idea of a retired Dr. Watson just chilling in LA always makes me smile.
Unfortunately, Rathbone left the series in 1947 after a 7-season run of playing the character for radio.
The series actually continued into the 50s with different Holmeses and different Watsons, and courtesy of the BBC, numerous Holmes series have been made throughout the 80s, 90s, and 2000s. And they're also wonderful, attracting amazing actors like Brian Blessed, Roger Rees, Andrew Sachs, and Dame Judi Dench. Indeed, if you go over to Big Finish right now, you'll find a Holmes series still ongoing, starring the voice of the Daleks, Nicholas Briggs. These are, of course, all incredible, and I encourage you to give them a listen. But there was a magic in those old Rathbone Bruce early adaptations that's never really been replicated. So if you're in the mood for a mystery, give these a go. The choice is elementary.
Number 4, Superheroes. You may have noticed that superheroes are rather having their moment right now. But back in the golden age of radio, they were equally prolific.
Batman, Blue Beetle, and Dick Tracy all had their own programs. But the two biggest were definitely The Shadow, played in the first series by the great Orson Welles, and the Man of Steel himself, Superman. It's in the form of radio that these famous words were first immortalized.
Up in the sky, look, it's a bird, it's a plane, it's Superman!
The show ran from 1940 to 1949 to great success. Probably the most notable episode of this era came in 1946, in the episode Clan of the Fiery Cross, where Superman does battle with the KKK. Pretty heavy stuff for the superhero, even by today's standards. The show is pretty primitive compared to what we have today, but if you're a fan of the superhero genre, it's a really fun step back in time.
Number 3, Lights Out and Arch Obler's Plays. The radio program Lights Out began in 1934 under writer Willis Cooper. But many feel the show really began to hit its stride when playwright Arch Obler took over the series in 1936. The series' very first episode was called Burial Service and involved a paralyzed young girl being mistaken for dead and subsequently buried alive. This was considered incredibly gruesome for the era and kicked off what would become a really interesting horror series. These frequently political stories were inspirations for Rod Serling, who would later use a similar format in his television program, The Twilight Zone. After Obler's reign in Lights Out, he moved on to a new program, aptly named Arch Obler's Plays. Here, he continued telling political and disturbing stories and playing with the form of radio. A notable episode from this era was the James Cagney starring Johnny Got His Gun, based on the Dalton Trumbo novel of the same name. This anti-war story was told entirely from the perspective of a wounded soldier in his bed, unable to move. It's just the sort of story that's especially suited to radio. Horror novelist Stephen King described Obler's work thusly.
Obler was the genre's prime auteur. He played on the radio's two prime strengths. The mind's innate obedience, its willingness to see whatever someone suggests it to see, no matter how absurd. The second is the fact that fear and horror are binding emotions that knock our adult pins from beneath us and leave us groping in the dark like children who cannot find the light switch. Radio is, of course, a blind medium, and only Obler used it so well, or so completely.
Number 2. Suspense.
The name says it all. This CBS anthology series offers tales of suspense and horror. When it comes to old-time radio, this is some of the very best. Starting in 1940 with a pilot episode directed by none other than the master of suspense, Alfred Hitchcock, the series played on radios for over 20 years. The list of actors who came through suspense over the years is staggering.
Humphrey Bogart, Henry Fonda, Peter Lorre, Marlena Dietrich, Cary Grant, Lena Horne, Judy Garland, Jimmy Stewart, Kirk Douglas, Burt Lancaster, Olivia de Havilland, Lucille Ball, Bela Lugosi, Mickey Rooney, Gregory Peck, Tony Curtis, and future President of the United States, Ronald Reagan. And that is just scratching the surface. It's totally worth binging this whole show, but if you're looking for some standouts, I'd personally recommend Fugue in C Minor, a classic gothic tale starring the always creepy Vincent Price, The Dunwich Horror, a fantastically weird take on the H.P. Lovecraft short story, The Yellow Wallpaper, a disturbing tale based on the short story by Charlotte Perkins Gilman and starring Agnes Moorehead, Ghost Hunt, a very early example of the found footage genre, and The House on Cypress Canyon, probably the best known episode of the series. This one is a spooky crime story that should definitely be sought out. If you're craving a touch of the macabre, Suspense is a must download. And number 1, the Mercury Theater on the Air. The Mercury Theater was a rep company founded in New York by Orson Welles and John Houseman. As soon as they came on the scene in 1936, they were already making waves. Their very first production was a version of Macbeth set in Haiti with an entirely African-American cast. This was considered daring at the time. The very next year, they produced a socialist musical called The Cradle Will Rock. That show was so controversial that they had their theater padlocked, and they had to march their audience to a neighboring theater, where they watched the cast perform sans costume. The very next year, they did a version of Julius Caesar set in then-contemporary Nazi Germany. After directing an amazing 7-part radio adaptation of Les Mis, sans singing, Welles and Houseman were given the go-ahead by CBS to create the Mercury Theater on the Air. Later renamed to the Campbell's Playhouse after they gained a sponsor in Andy Warhol's favorite soup company, and then back to Mercury Summer of the Air for their final season. The show is great. They're extremely charming adaptations of classics, written, directed, and starring the young Welles. It's really fun to see him try and tackle every meaty role in Western literature, from Dracula to Hercule Poirot to Captain Bligh to King Lear, with varying but never boring results. The first season has music composed by frequent Hitchcock collaborator Bernard Herrmann, and it's predictably great. The supporting cast is almost always made up of Mercury Company regulars, but as the show goes on, they do take on some notable guest stars, such as Katharine Hepburn in Farewell to Arms and Laurence Olivier in Beau Guest.
Larry Olivier, for example, is a terrible radio actor.
But on stage, then?
Well, he needs his 3 or 4 days.
Some of the stories were even done multiple times, with the only consistent being Welles. There are 3 episodes featuring the story of Jane Eyre, each with a different cast and script, with Welles being Rochester every time, a role he would later play on film. He does A Christmas Carol twice, once with Welles' Scrooge, and the second time taking a backseat to Lionel Barrymore's interpretation. There was a very much shortened second outing of Les Mis, this time with Wells as the villain Javert and Walter Houston taking over as the hero Valjean.
Still no singing, but it's made up for when the Mercury takes on Around the World in 80 Days.
This one is a musical adaptation of the Jules Verne story, with music by Cole Porter and lyrics by Noel Coward. The Mercury Players, of course, eventually made the leap to Hollywood, where you can see them in The Magnificent Ambersons and, of course, Citizen Kane, widely considered to be one of the greatest films ever made. If you are only going to listen to one episode of this show, however, it has to be the Mercury's adaptation of War of the Worlds by H.G. Wells. The story is performed in the style of a radio news broadcast. Apparently, this was so convincing, they had the people of America convinced that they were being invaded by creatures from another planet, in what would become the most effective radio hoax in history. If you want to hear more about this, there's a fantastic interview played after one of the episodes of Campbell's Playhouse between the young Orson and the aging H.G. Wells, in which they discuss the event. It's really worth a listen. Both guys have the most unique voices and pack a lot of interesting talking points into just 7 minutes.
I find him the most delightful carrier. He carries my name and an extra E that I hope he'll drop sooner or later. See no sense in it.
I think that's the nicest thing that a man from England could possibly say about the men from Mars.
When it comes to the golden age of radio, it doesn't get any better than this. My highest recommendation, be sure to give it a listen. And if your iPhone isn't filled up yet, be sure to tune in next week when I'll go through the top audio dramas from 1970 to the present day. Don't fail to be there. Congratulations! You made it to the end! Welcome to the Rap Party! Be sure to grab a snack and to like and subscribe to keep on top of all this very good content. I'm William Jordan. Until next time.